still needs to be done moving forward. Plus, council members in Troy upset with the Troy Police Department because of the recent spike in violent crime and are now urging the police chief to better deploy resources.
And it's a little bit breezy to occasionally windy out there, feeling a little fallish for some. We'll let you know how long this pleasant weather will last. What's in store for the holiday weekend? News 10 at noon is coming up next.
Dedicated, determined, dependable. This is News 10 ABC at noon.
It was 3 years ago that heavy rains from Tropical Storm Irene first started pounding our area. Today, a look at the progress made and the efforts still needed. Good afternoon and thanks so much for joining us on News 10 ABC at noon. I'm Stephanie Grady in for Christina today. Schoharie County, you may remember, was one of the hardest hit areas during Tropical Storm Irene back in 2011. And many volunteers have come together to help with the rebuilding process. But one group specifically, the Schoharie Area Long Term, also known as SALT, is marking this 3-year anniversary with a special press conference wrapping up just a short time ago. News 10 ABC's Amy Cutler is live for us this afternoon in Schoharie County with much more on today's meeting. Good afternoon, Amy.
Good afternoon, Stephanie. It is really remarkable to see driving here along Route 30. We pass through Schoharie, Middleburg, North Blenheim, and Blenheim. Many homes have been repaired or rebuilt. Many businesses have reopened, but there is still a long ways to go. Behind me here, we are at the Blenheim Community Center. This is where the press conference to mark the 3-year anniversary is taking place. It's just wrapped up. 3 years since Irene hit, devastating many around here and beyond. The event is called 3 years long, 3 years strong, the focus on how neighbors came together. Many vowed to come back stronger following Irene, and they have. But there's still plenty of work to be done. Officials estimate 73% of residents have come back. 15%, though, are still in need. This community center used to be a church. It housed a food pantry along with a thrift store. Many around here are hoping that they can expand that, so still a lot of work to be done. Now, we do plan to head to some hard-hit areas, and we'll have much more starting at 4 o'clock. For now, we are live in Blenheim. I'm Amy Cutler for News 10 ABC.
Thank you, Amy. Continuing coverage now on the effort to cut crime in the Collar City. Troy City Council members held a press conference this morning to address the recent outbreak of violent crime in Troy. Council members now asking for a larger police presence, and they say they want safety to be the number one priority in the city. News 10 ABC's Lindsay Nielsen was at that press conference this morning and joins us live now with more.
Stephanie, Troy council members are asking the police department to rework officers so that more can be out on the street. One council member very angry today because he says that when the chief did say yesterday, you know, asking residents to be patient, he said that is just not the right message at this time and that residents expect more, and he called it misguided leadership. Now, on Wednesday, Troy Police Chief Tedesco and Mayor Lou Rosamilia did say that officers were tired, but that they were handling the recent rash of violence very well and that investigations would lead to solved crimes. But today, Troy City Council held its own conference encouraging the department to rework officers. And also, they asked if a street crime unit could be brought back. Gordon says priorities need to be realigned.
If we need to hire more cops, fund more overtime. People want cops on the street. People need to see cops. We have problems with gangs. Address them.
Now, I was told yesterday that the police chief and the council members, they did meet as well as the mayor to discuss some of these new ideas, but it's not known at this time how long that would take. I was told they're going to meet again each week and then another month later just to see if these changes could be made. And now the police chief and the mayor are meeting again with the media in just a couple of minutes, so we will be there for that. We'll bring you more on this and what residents have to say in later editions of News 10. For now, live in Troy, Lindsay Nielsen, News 10 ABC.
Thank you, Lindsay. We have an update now on the case of the Amish girls who were abducted earlier this month. The hospital that employed one of the suspects in the case now conducting its own investigation into the possibility that Stephen Howells Jr. stole drugs from the hospital. Howells worked as an RN at Claxton Hepburn Medical Center in Ogdensburg before he was arrested this month on charges of kidnapping with the intent to physically or sexually abuse the girls. He, along with Nicole Vaisley, the other suspect, are now being held without bail. In Gloversville, state police announcing arrests in two disturbing cases yesterday. The first case, a 32-year-old man has been arrested for sexually abusing a child and posting pictures of the assault online. Richard Dentz Jr. is now facing a number of charges in this case, including criminal sex act and promoting a sexual performance by a child. He was sent to the Fulton County Jail as this investigation continues. Police say more charges could be filed. Happening now, union activists, clergy, and community members rallying at the west steps of the Capitol in Albany to demand moral leadership and oppose inequality. Marking the 51st anniversary of the March on Washington back on August 28, 1963, more than 100 people gathering right now at the state capitol encouraging others to elect leaders that prioritize the common good. The event is organized as part of a national Moral Week of Action as rallies are being held at 12 state capitals across the country. Again, this event just started at noon at West Capitol Park in Albany. News 10 ABC's Heather Kovar is there and will have updates beginning on News 10 ABC at 4. A possible agreement between the casino developer and East Greenbush and Albany city leaders may garner Albany support. The Gaming Commission's site selection board that will determine where the first of four upstate Las Vegas-style casinos will go is in the process of making a selection. One thing the board considers in all of this, the potential economic impact on the region. And that's what East Greenbush's partnership with Albany is supposed to highlight. The deal offered by Capital View Casino Resort is non-exclusive. It would guarantee Albany is targeted for 25% of the casino's new jobs. Transportation for those workers would also be provided, and the casino would give $1 million every year for 10 years of all the money they make to the city. Albany Mayor Kathy Sheehan says she is on board with this proposal.
We all know that the city of Albany is struggling. We have to be able to invest in the future of the city.
The money from East Greenbush would go to Capitalize Albany Corporation, a not-for-profit that creates, retains, and attracts businesses. But East Greenbush is not alone in seeking the city of Albany's support. Rensselaer also looking to Albany for an endorsement for its casino. Albany Mayor Kathy Sheehan says that so far, Rensselaer's plan hasn't been specific enough on how it will benefit surrounding communities, but she says she's open to further discussion with city officials there. The Albany Common Council has not voiced support for any casino project thus far. Happening today, the Saratoga Racecourse saluting our nation's service members, past and present, for Military Appreciation Day. NYRA paying tribute to its service members and veteran employees with a special ceremony in the winner's circle. Later, veterans of World War II will ring the traditional Saratoga bell in the winner's circle to mark the 70th anniversary of the D-Day invasion and the Battle of the Bulge. Representatives from several service members and veteran support groups will be on hand today to provide more information about their services. Now, if you plan on heading to the track today, the gates opened up just about an hour ago in today's post time, just about 20 minutes from now at 12:25. Also happening today, first-year students at Siena College are checking in and setting up their new digs for this semester's big move-in day. Members of the Siena community, as well as the college's new interim president, Father Edward Coughlin, helping the new students unload their cars today, unpack all those boxes, and unwind on campus as all the students begin to experience life at Siena. This year's freshman class comes from 22 different states and 7 foreign countries. Siena has been providing education for more than 75 years. Such an exciting time of year. Well, just a few miles away from Siena, the Albany College of Pharmacy, along with the Albany Fire Department, burning down the house, or dorm room rather. They made a mocked up 8 by 8 foot dorm room that looked like a typical college student's room, setting fire to that big setup that showed how many dangers can lurk in the residential halls and how important fire safety is. Still ahead right here on News 10 ABC at noon. Does the White House need permission from Congress to launch airstrikes over Syria? The Obama administration is suggesting that it does not. And the U.S. is checking reports of a second American killed in Syria. We'll have the latest on this when we come back. First, though, here's meteorologist Steve Teeling with a preview of that forecast. And Steve, it is cool out there. I have to say, it's cool.
It's breezy to windy. It's cool. It's less humid. A little fall-like conditions in the air, shall we say. Yeah, it's cool. How long will it stay cool? And what about this upcoming holiday weekend? Stick around. Your Storm Tracker forecast is going to cover all that. That's next.
Here's meteorologist Steve Teeling with your Storm Tracker forecast.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back. Meteorologist Steve Teeling here. Hope you're having a fantastic day. Yeah, a little fall in the air, wouldn't you say? Let's take a look at some of the conditions out there. Almost a fall-looking sky. It actually looks scary in some parts of our region, but don't worry. We're not even expecting any showers, let alone thunderstorms. Just a lot of moisture-laden clouds that are giving it the dark gray and almost blackish kind of hue to it. This is 787 around exit 9. You can see we've been experiencing a mixture of clouds and sunshine. Let's get you to our North Adams webcam, first of all. And this is also going to show a little bit of a mix of clouds and sunshine out that way. Hey, that the helicopter's gone, but the old car is back. A couple of days ago, I mean, the helicopter's been sitting there for about a week. That is now gone. That old car was there earlier this week, and I haven't seen it. Now it's back. Looks like its hood is up. It's got to be one of the people that work there. I don't know. I don't know why I get into this stuff, this silly stuff, but it's just interesting, very interesting. Anyway, mixture of clouds and sunshine out towards northern Berkshire County. A little bit more in the way of sun trying to poke on through here in Brunswick on our webcam. So for the most part, I'm going to say a mixture of clouds and sunshine. How about this Dunkin' Donuts Storm Tracker weather camera from Stuyvesant Plaza? Yeah, it almost looks like it's scary right above us, but the further out to the distance you look, more in the way of some sunshine. Anyway, one more time, clouds and sun mixed together, that's what we're looking at. All right, it was partly cloudy this morning. See how the clouds melted away, and then see how the sun works on the atmosphere. All these fair weather cumulus clouds pop up, and that's what we're experiencing across our region. God bless you, Stephanie. Look at this. That's hurricane. It's looking pretty impressive right now. Still a minimal hurricane, Cristobal, at 75 mile an hour, but it might be updated to even stronger than that. It looks like the eye is really, really getting wound up. So we'll have to wait and see what the National Hurricane Center says about that in a couple of hours. Nonetheless, it has no impact on our weather. Moving off to the northeast at about 26 miles an hour. By this time tomorrow, it won't even be on our map. How about that? Currently, we're looking at 72 degrees, but the thing I want you to notice are the winds. Northwest 14 this hour, gusting to 17. At times, they've been gusting between 20 and 25 miles an hour. So general 70s across our region. 71 Colony in Schenectady. We have 71 in Brunswick, Buskirk at 72. Up to the Adirondacks. I don't know if some of you guys are even going to get out of the 60s today. We're at an even 60 in Saranac Lake, Indian Lake 64, and Mount Van Hovenberg at 61 degrees. Pittsfield, you spiked up to 71, but Lanesboro 69, Alford at 69, and Great Barrington at an even 70. All right, for today, mixture of clouds and sunshine. Tonight into tomorrow morning, it'll be clear. The winds will calm down. It's going to be very cool, if not chilly for some. But we rebound nicely for Friday with plenty of sunshine. We'll see a high get into the upper 70s. Now, Friday night into Saturday morning, it turns partly cloudy. But for Saturday, even though we're going to see warmer temps and more humidity start to move in, I am going to keep the day on Saturday dry. That's what we're looking at right now. Then Saturday night into Sunday morning, a frontal boundary is going to head our way. So that Sunday morning, yeah, there could be a few showers around. And I think that front's going to kind of hang around for Sunday, Monday. That will give us the chance of some scattered showers and some thunderstorms for Sunday and for Monday, but it doesn't look like a washout at this point. Up at the track today, partly cloudy, breezy, and comfortable. Your high should be right around 76 degrees. So again, today, breezy, if not windy at times, 76 the high, mix of clouds and sun. Everything clears out, calms down tonight. Lows in the 40s in a lot of areas, but 52 downtown. Now, your seven-day outlook goes like this. Tomorrow's going to be a nice, fair day, still low humidity, 77. The warmth and the humidity increases Saturday, but it stays dry. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, that's going to really feel like summertime. Mid-80s, lots of humidity, and the chance of that kind of heat of the day shower and thunderstorm possibility.
Yeah, and you know, this summer we've kind of done the up and down roller coaster, hot and humid, cool and nice for a few days, kind of back and forth. In the past few days, we've seen that heat and humidity. Yesterday was a scorcher.
That's right.
Now until the front moved through.
Until the front moved through. Now today and tomorrow is going to be comfortable, then right back to the heat. So the pattern continues. It's been stubborn all season long.
Yeah, unfortunately, we're kind of getting that taste of summer back just in time for the end, right?
We knew that would happen. We knew it.
Thanks, Steve.
All right.
For today's Inside Look at the Saratoga Racecourse, we're taking a look back at the exciting finish to the Traverse Stakes over the weekend. If you stayed home on Saturday and missed the race, this is what you missed. A crowd of 46,000 strong filling the racecourse. Seas of fans all over the place, from trackside to inside the clubhouse, even in the backyard. And they all got to see quite the race. 20-1 long shot, VE Day, beating out favorites Wicked Strong and Tonalist. Definitely an exciting one for sure. Still ahead right here on News 10 ABC at noon, after less than one day of deliberation, the jury has made a decision regarding the Texas father accused of gunning down a drunk driver who killed his two young sons. We'll have a look at that result when we come back.
You're watching News 10 ABC at noon.
As the increased threat of the Islamic militant group known as ISIS expands, the Obama administration weighs whether to take action in Syria. Susan Sawney has the latest now from Washington.
I am Shirley Sotloff. My son Stephen is in your hands.
Still no indication this morning that a mother's anguished plea directly to the leader of the terror group ISIS has had any impact. Shirley Sotloff addressed her last-ditch appeal to Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who claims he is the caliph, the prince of the Muslim world. And that is how she addressed him in her message, broadcast on Arabic language television.
I've always learned that you, the caliph, can grant amnesty.
A freelance reporter, 31-year-old Stephen Sotloff was last seen alive at the end of the disturbing video released last week, which showed the beheading of American journalist James Foley. The ISIS militant in that video spoke directly to President Obama, calling on him to end American airstrikes against ISIS in Iraq. ISIS is a sophisticated, growing, and well-funded group that has shown no mercy as it has conducted its ruthless holy war across Syria and Iraq. Thousands of innocent civilians have already been executed. Could one mother's video to the self-proclaimed caliph save her son's life?
The idea that he would be swayed by this video doesn't strike me as likely.
In addition to Sotloff, ISIS is holding two other Americans hostage.
They're going to prove that they're cold-blooded, that they're ruthless, and they're going to carry it out.
Now they are even using drones to gather overhead intelligence on targets. And they have captured a wide range of advanced Iraqi military equipment, much of it American, left behind by the U.S.
President Obama is meeting with his National Security Council later today to gather intelligence reports about possible ISIS targets inside Syria. Susan Solney, ABC News, Washington.
There is new information on the fate of Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 and where the lost plane could be now. Authorities say the plane may have turned south earlier than previously thought. Australia's Deputy Prime Minister says the search area remains focused in the southern Indian Ocean. For months, though, investigators have been poring over satellite and radar data to try and determine the doomed plane's flight path. Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 vanished back on March 8th, and since then, searchers have found no trace of the aircraft or anyone on board. Next week, federal researchers will begin testing an experimental vaccine to prevent the deadly Ebola virus on humans. The National Institutes of Health announcing today that it is launching the safety trial on a vaccine. It will test 20 healthy adult volunteers to see if the virus is safe and triggers an adequate response in their immune systems. That testing being held in Bethesda, Maryland. American health officials are also talking about a future trial in Nigeria. So far, the deadly Ebola virus has killed more than 1,500 people in West Africa. Ukraine's president called an emergency meeting of the nation's Security Council today to discuss the growing crisis in Ukraine. A top NATO official has said at least 1,000 Russian troops have poured into Ukraine with sophisticated equipment and that there has been direct contact with Ukrainian soldiers resulting in casualties. A Ukrainian official says two columns of Russian tanks and military vehicles fired missiles at a border post today and then rolled into Ukraine as border guards fled. Britain's UN ambassador says Russia will be asked to explain why its troops are in Ukraine. Still to come right here on News 10 ABC at noon, officers in Colorado were looking for an active shooter. What they found, though, was a dangerous hoax called swatting. When we return, more on this case that now has the FBI involved.
You're watching News 10 ABC at Noon.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm News 10 ABC's Stephanie Grady. A man whose two children were hit and killed by a drunk driver has now been cleared of murder charges. The ruling came as a relief to David Barajas and what's left of his family. He and his two sons were on an unlit road in Texas in December of 2012. Their truck had run out of gas. The three were pushing it down the road when a drunk driver slammed into the boys, killing them both. 20-year-old Jose Banda, who you just saw, would never be arrested because that night, in the darkness, he was shot and killed. Prosecutors claim by the boy's father. But nobody ever actually saw the shooting, and no one ever found the gun. The defense argued it was someone else who killed Jose Banda.
What the defense did in this case, which I think was very clever, was they didn't exactly say he had it coming, he deserved it. They gave the jury an opportunity to acquit, but on the evidence that was before them.
And the defense was able to convince jurors that Barajas could not be convicted of murder beyond a reasonable doubt. A 911 prank did not leave Colorado police laughing. It triggered a massive police and SWAT response and put schools on lockdown right around the lunch hour yesterday. Police have now asked the FBI to help find out who called 911 and reported that he had killed coworkers inside a building near Mineral and Broadway. It appears to be the work of someone who wanted the whole event to go live over the internet. His target was broadcasting an online gaming site. Chris Vanderveen reports.
All units on a possible homicide.
The call comes in around 11:30 a.m.
RP states that he shot his coworkers. He is hiding in his office. He has his friends tied up. Break.
At the same time, in that office, a popular gamer known as Kutra is online. Live streaming has worked to a massive audience on the website Twitch. See him there?
Uh-oh. This isn't good.
It doesn't take long for Kutra to realize his imaginary world is about to get a dose of reality.
What in the world? I think we're getting swatted.
Swatting. Urban Dictionary calls it a goal where the hacker tricks 911 systems into deploying SWAT to an unsuspecting victim's home.
Put your hands up! Put your hands up!
Or in this case, an unsuspecting victim's business.
Didn't know what was going on. A lot of commotion.
In the meantime, what you would expect to happen...
Don't expect it here.
When someone calls 911 saying, I've killed people.
It's obviously swarming now.
Well, it happens. Police agencies from all over the southern metro area respond. Soon enough, police inside start to realize maybe this was just a prank.
Did not find any indication or any evidence that any shooting had occurred. We have no victims of any gunshots. We have no crime scene that we've been able to identify.
Whoever called 911 committed a crime, a serious one that will undoubtedly attract the attention of the feds.
Whoever called in must have had our address.
So much more than a prank, say those impacted. In a virtual reality world, sometimes reality can be just as disturbing as it sounds.
And that was Chris Vanderveen with that story. On drugs and in control of a 35-ton vehicle. That's what security footage shows on board a bus in Sydney, Australia. Take a look at this. The video allegedly shows 35-year-old Sean Murphy smoking synthetic marijuana behind the wheel of a city bus. For a time, he's seen driving with his elbow, almost completely losing control, even looking like he's losing consciousness at one point. He completely passes out, veers off the road, slamming into a fence and then into a home. Fortunately, no one was hurt in this terrible accident. Murphy pleaded guilty to numerous charges. Test results found morphine and methamphetamine in his system as well. A natural gas leak is being blamed for a home explosion and fire in Dallas on Tuesday morning. Surveillance cameras capturing that blast. You see it here. And a neighbor recorded the flames as she ran to escape. The blast shattered windows, even melted blinds inside the home. Studs still stood, but brick walls, they were blown down. What's the most remarkable part of this story? A mother and her five children were able to escape. Dallas Fire Rescue determined the explosion and fire to be an accidental one caused by a gas leak inside that home. It is 12:30 right now. We want to check in with meteorologist Steve Teeling for an updated look at our storm tracker forecast. And Steve, we know it's cool out there. It's breezy. If you like fall, you're getting a taste of it today, right?
You really are. You definitely are, Stephanie. That's for sure. Let's get you outside and watch the clouds just billow up and pop up on our satellite loop here. You can see that. Yeah, it looks all nice and quiet. Then boom. It doesn't, but they're all, it's speckled looking, for lack of a better term, where you do have some sun coming through, but then some thicker cloud cover in other spots. So that's how it's going to be throughout the rest of this afternoon, no doubt about it. We're looking at a system off to the Midwest. That system is going to be bringing some heavy rains out in that area the next couple of days, and it will eventually move our way, although I'm not looking at heavy rains. I think I'm just looking at maybe some scattered showers and thunderstorms for part of this upcoming weekend. All right, 72 degrees, our current number in Albany right now, 71 for Pittsfield. Look at North Adams, even 73 with Glens Falls, and then holding on to the 60s on up in the Adirondacks. Close to 80, New Haven, Connecticut. Boston and Providence, you are at 80, but look it off to our west. That's where our air is coming from. Only in the 60s, Buffalo, Syracuse, Fort Drum, on into the Binghamton area. So we're going 76 for the high here today. And we'll say a mix of clouds and sun, breezy to occasionally windy conditions for the rest of the day. In case you missed the weekend outlook, we'll check that out again for you. So stay tuned for that. Steph.
All right, Steve, thanks. Still ahead right here on News 10 ABC at noon. More concerns over a data breach this afternoon. The FBI saying it's investigating cyber attacks on several U.S. banks. Coming up, we'll tell you why some believe it's connected to the U.S. sanctions imposed on Russia for that country's action in Ukraine.
You're watching News 10 ABC at noon.
Federal agents are now investigating after hackers targeted one of America's biggest banks. ABC's Marcy Gonzalez tells us who could be behind the cyber attack and what JP Morgan Chase says this means for its customers.
A cyber attack on one of the nation's biggest banks. Sources calling it a potentially major breach at JP Morgan Chase and at least one other financial institution earlier this month. One official telling ABC News that when a bank this large is targeted, it isn't just a financial crime, but also a possible national security matter. Now the FBI and Secret Service are investigating, looking into whether Russian hackers could be responsible, a possible retaliation for sanctions imposed on Russia by the West over the conflict in Ukraine.
Could it be a combination of retaliation but also while we're doing it, let's just see what else we can grab, quite possibly.
Investigators are looking into what kind of information the hackers may have accessed and whether it could have included customer account information. For now, a spokesperson for JPMorgan Chase says they have detected no unusual fraud activity.
So far, what we know, the details are murky. JPMorgan says they have many layers of security and not to worry, but of course we're worried because this is a terrifying idea.
And JPMorgan Chase is working with federal investigators to get to the bottom of this, saying customers should contact the bank if they suspect their accounts have been compromised. Marcy Gonzalez, ABC News, New York.
It is time now to get you caught up in some of today's top stories. It was 3 years ago today that heavy rains from Tropical Storm Irene first started pounding our area. Schoharie County, one of the hardest hit areas during Tropical Storm Irene back in 2011. And many volunteers have come together to help with the rebuilding process there. But one group specifically, the Schoharie Area Long Term, also known as SALT, is marking this 3-year anniversary with a special press conference. They held it this morning. The event was called 3 years Long, 3 years Strong. The focus was on how neighbors came together. Many vowed to come back stronger following Irene, and they have. But there's still plenty of work to be done. Officials estimate 73% of residents have come back. 15%, though, are still in need. News 10 ABC's Amy Cutler plans to go back to some of the hardest hit areas this afternoon, and we'll have much more on how they're doing. That's all ahead on News 10 ABC, beginning at 4. During a press conference this morning, Troy council members urging the Troy Police Department to rework its officers and better deploy resources. One member upset today during the meeting because yesterday the police chief was asking residents to be patient and said that crime overall was down in the city despite the recent outbreak of violent crime. Now the council did meet yesterday with the chief and said they are discussing these new ideas to improve safety in the city, but it could take a while before any changes are made or approved. The chief and mayor are now responding to the city council meeting in a press conference. We'll have more on that coming up a little bit later on News 10 ABC. To our business news this afternoon, after 7 years of topping the list of America's favorite credit cards, American Express finally has some competition. According to J.D. Power's annual report on credit card satisfaction, Discover tied American Express for the number one spot. Both companies received scores of 819 out of a 1,000-point scale. Chase ranks next in customer satisfaction with a score of 789. Barclay Card, U.S. Bank, and Wells Fargo round out the top five. The rankings are based on responses from credit card customers. Qantas Airlines has reported a $2.6 billion loss that stems from tough domestic competition, a struggling long-haul business, and a massive write-down of the value of its fleet. But stock in the Australian airlines surged 7% in Sydney as investors welcome news Qantas will separate its domestic and international businesses, possibly attracting new investors to the long-haul operation. A recent survey found that for many Americans this summer, vacation wasn't a complete getaway. Thanks to electronic devices, workers have more options to check in at the office as the last long weekend of the summer approaches, talking about Labor Day weekend. Summer is coming to an unofficial close, of course, and while many Americans took a vacation this summer, most of us didn't really get away from it all. A recent survey by TripAdvisor found 77% of Americans confessed to doing some work away from the office, some motivated by guilt, others by the boss. The most common activities, according to the survey, 9 in 10 American workers have checked their email while on vacation, and 85% responded to those emails.
20% said it's a guilt thing. They feel like they have this need to check in on vacation. And then another 1 in 5 said they really think their boss expects them to be checking email and working even when they're out.
Americans have one final long weekend of summer this coming weekend to unplug. Experts recommend designating a trusted coworker to handle the little things that may pop up at work and letting others know this person is helping you while you are away. Still to come right here on News 10 ABC at noon, what would you do if your wedding engagement simply fell apart? Many would cry or even retreat, but a Philadelphia man decided to squeeze the sour taste of his breakup into something sweet. We'll explain after the break. Well, it is hard to believe track season at the Saratoga Racecourse is almost over. This is the final Thursday of racing at the track. So for a look at what's on tap today and who you may want to put your money on, Liana Bonavita has today's handicapper report.
Hey guys, just 5 days left in the Saratoga meet. That means only 3 days left with our handicapper, Capital OTB analyst Jeff Carl. Jeff, we have a couple nice races today. The With Anticipation Stakes for the two-year-olds. Who do you like in this one?
I like Hot Tin Roof. He won his debut at Presque Isle Downs and his first start. And that's a synthetic racetrack, and generally horses that run well in synthetics transfers nicely to the turf. He's 6-1 in the morning line with Grand Motion and Rajiv Mirage, so I'm taking a little bit of a shot with him, but I like Hot Tin Roof in the With Anticipation.
And the With Anticipation, the fifth race on the card, where are we going to go from here?
Let's go to the ninth race. It's an allowance race on the turf, 5.5 furlongs. I'll go with Golden Rifle. He's looking for his fourth straight win. The last three were at Belmont Park this spring. He's been freshened up a little bit. I think that'll set him up very nicely for 4 in a row for trainer Chad Brown.
Chad Brown definitely can use a couple more wins here if he wants to contend for this training title. Let's go now to your long shot pick.
Let's go to the second race, the number 2, Peanuts and Popcorn.
Peanuts and Popcorn.
Yeah, he's run 2 even races going 7 furlongs. He's going to stretch out tomorrow to 1.8 miles. Maybe that'll do the trick. Get him in the winner's circle. He's 10-1 in the morning line.
Sounds a little bit like a circus. Peanuts and Popcorn. I like it here. Hope you guys can make it down to Saratoga. It should be a great day. Back to you.
That sounds great. And yeah, can you believe that? Today is the final Thursday of this summer's meet. Whew, time flies by, right? Well, hey, it seems like our Labor Day weekend is shaping up to be better than we first thought earlier this week. So we want to check in with meteorologist Steve Teeling. Not to put any extra pressure on you there, Teeling, but I'm putting it on. Sorry, this is our last unofficial weekend of summer.
Quite all right. You see these broad shoulders, baby?
Yeah.
You see them? No, I'm kidding. Listen, you know what? It does look better. Saturday absolutely looks like it'll be dry and nice, so we're going to count our blessings there. Doesn't mean Sunday and Monday will be perfect, but maybe just not a threat of heavy rain. We'll talk about that in a moment. Let's get you outside to our traffic camera. This is kind of a different shot, if you will. Right above the camera, you've got some thick, dark clouds, and out in the distance, you have some bright sunshine, and that's what's coming through the camera lens right now. Traffic is moving along nicely, and all these clouds around, no precip with them. We're going to look at the radar in a moment. Our Mount Snow webcam, if you were with us this morning, you saw that Mount Snow was socked in with the clouds and the fog, but now you're seeing a mixture of clouds and sunshine streaming on across the region. Same deal in Hessville, pretty much a blend of clouds and sunshine. And same thing here, our Dunkin' Donuts Storm Tracker weather camera high atop our studios. It might even be clear over us, but you can see some of those clouds out in the distance. So we'll split the difference there and say partly cloudy. That's how it'll be all afternoon and evening, long before these clouds get out of here. It does appear that we are going to see the northwest flow continue, and we are going to see that bring in the cooler air as well. So we widen out the view just a little bit. We're going to take one last look at Cristobal, and you can see that it's a hurricane still moving rapidly away from the eastern seaboard. See, it's pretty well defined eye here, but it's only a minimal hurricane at this point. 75 miles an hour moving away from the U.S. Yeah, thank God for that. We don't want anything like Lee or Irene we saw 3 years ago. Definitely nothing like that. Glens Falls 73, Ticonderoga 68. These are current numbers. 71 in Pittsfield, out to Stamford 65. Duanesburg, you're at 66. Down to the deep south, that's where you find the 80s and the humidity, although this isn't really oppressive for even you guys down there this time of year. All right, we're going to show the big picture. Our first spot and our first look will be the hurricane. Look at that, moving out to sea, the North Atlantic, say goodbye to that. So that's the last we'll talk about, Cristobal. Friday morning, high pressure still in control, giving us a lot of sun, a few clouds, and a very fine day. Now into Saturday, this is Saturday morning, 7 a.m., we should still have the high pressure hanging on, even though we have a frontal boundary coming our way from the Great Lakes. But I think Saturday is going to be dry. We'll call it partly cloudy, a little warmer, a little more humid, but not a bad day. Then on Sunday, it all depends on what this front does after it comes in. Some of the models keep it over us. Some of us retreat it back up to the north as a warm front. So we're just going to have to wait and see. My call right now for Sunday and Monday will be kind of a little hazy sun and clouds, maybe that scattered shower thunderstorm from time to time, but not an all-day rain. So today, no rain whatsoever, breezy, clouds and sun, 76 the high. Overnight tonight, we're looking at skies clearing out, winds calming down, and that means temperatures will drop. Close to 50 downtown, well in the 40s, the outlying areas. Here is your 7-day outlook. Warmer and a little more humid Saturday. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, we're all going to probably be in the warm sector of things, so mid-80s, kind of humid. Actually, very humid as it looks right now, with a chance of that scattered afternoon and evening shower or thunderstorm. Maybe a little cooler and drier by next Wednesday. So not maybe the best of weekends, Steph, but certainly not the worst.
We're seeing improvement, Steve. It's great. Thank you for that. Here's a look now at the call of the day from the track yesterday. This one coming from the PG Johnson Stakes.
There's one furlong to go, and Partisan Politics now in front. Partisan Politics, a tap or two now, and she's on her way to a three-quarter of a length lead over Sunday Sun at the Pacemaker, and then Ancient Goddess. It will be Partisan Politics, Javier Castellano, three-length win.
Partisan Politics picking up her first career win in that race yesterday. Keep it here. We'll be right back.
You're watching News 10 ABC at noon.
A man who had to cancel his wedding at the very last minute could have wallowed in grief. Instead, he's using his already paid for reception to help needy children. Wendy Bell shows us how.
Phil LeBoon was getting married this Saturday.
Things just didn't work out for one reason or another. And so I ended up calling off the wedding pretty last minute.
He'd booked the Priory for his reception and paid for all the food and the booze. So now what? Well, Phil decided to squeeze the sour taste of his breakup into something sweet.
So we were kind of talking about it, me and my friends, and we were talking about almost like Farm Aid. Like this could be lemon aid, and it could be used to, you know, help these kids. And it's also turning the lemons that I got into lemon aid.
Those kids he's talking about, they live in third world countries, children born with devastating medical problems. So Phil turned his prepaid wedding reception into a fundraiser for Surgicore.
And it just snowballed into this massive event where we're getting tens of thousands of dollars in donations. We're selling hundreds of tickets.
Once word got out, his phone started ringing.
Gift baskets, donations from $50 up to our largest was $12,000.
Houses at Disney World, trips to Cancun, internet packages and websites.
I imagine this is going to be unlike most charity events out there.
Phil's sour split quickly sweetened into a labor of love.
It makes you feel really good that we're literally going to be changing a massive amount of kids' lives. It makes it almost feel like it's not the worst thing in the world that I had to cancel a wedding.
This one breakup may in fact make up to $50,000 for children in need.
I'm really excited to see what the end result of this is, which is all the smiling kids' faces.
What a great effort that is. That was Wendy Bell with that story. We'll be right back with the final check of the forecast. Stay with us. It is time now for a look at what's coming up on News 10 ABC beginning at 4. Continued coverage of the three-year anniversary of Tropical Storm Irene. Signs of progress in hard-hit Schoharie County as neighbors remember how they came together in such a difficult time. Plus, marking the anniversary of the March on Washington with a call to vote. The event going on today on the Capitol steps, calling on citizens to vote their dreams. And ISIS militants continue their campaign of terror in Iraq. What actions the president is considering taking in the Middle East will have these stories and much more, along with an updated look at the storm tracker forecast. That's all coming to you live from the Saratoga Racetrack on News 10 ABC beginning at 4. Well, finally from us this noon, two major topics trending on social media today. The first, globally popular children's character Hello Kitty turns 40 this year. And with that birthday comes a surprise revelation. Her creators say Hello Kitty is not a cat. The company that owns Hello Kitty describes Hello Kitty as a little girl from London. In fact, Hello Kitty has her own real cat as a pet named Charmy Kitty. Who knew? And speaking of who knew, Brad Pitt and Angelina? Yeah, they're married. The couple tied the knot Saturday in France in a private ceremony held at their sprawling Miraval wine-growing estate there. The fact that the public is just finding out this news today is pretty incredible, with social media out there, of course, paparazzi being crazy about the two of them. Brangelina, I can't believe they kept it secret. Can't wait to see those pictures.
It's very difficult. I give them kudos and credit. Yeah. I may not be the big fan of Hollywood and everything like that. For two huge stars like that to keep that quiet, that is very impressive.
Pretty incredible. How about the forecast? Looking better for the holiday weekend, Steve. Not incredible.
Not incredible, not impressive, but better. It looks like turning more hot and humid over the weekend, maybe a passing thunderstorm.
Good weekend to both. Thanks for staying with us. We'll see you at 4.